Hi, we're here at the Geosynthetic Institute in Folsom, Pennsylvania, taking a look at ASTM D as in David 4716, or Transmissivity in-plane flow characteristics of geocomposites, geonets, geospacers. These materials are typically consist of a core and a textile. The textile is typically bonded to the core. The textile is used as a filter. The core, or the spacer, is used for transmission of fluid. Soil is placed against the textile, water filters through the geotextile, and then subsequently moves in plane through the core or the spacer. This is the unit, the transmissivity unit. It's broken down into three parts. It has an upstream reservoir, a normal pressure where the specimen is housed, and then the outlet works downstream. The geosynthetic is typically placed inside of the holder. It is a specimen. The specimen is typically 300 millimeters by 300 millimeters. It's typically a little long, 25 millimeters on each side, so that you can push it into the upstream reservoir and subsequently the downstream outlet works. Critically important not to have any air in the interstices of the spacer or the net, so therefore you place typically a plexiglass lid over top of it. Then you're going to need some sort of seal. We use a closed cell foam for this particular case so that we don't have any leakage around the perimeter of the holder, and then a big pressure plate so that we can apply the normal pressure. Subsequent to that, we have to place a load cell, and then we load the system up to the prescribed normal pressure. In this test, you typically have three normal pressures and three gradients, which are prescribed by the owner. So you apply the normal pressure. Okay, the normal pressure is applied, and you should notice that you have three types of creep here. You actually have a compression or consolidation of the overlying soil. You have a tension creep of the textile into the interstices of the net. And you also might have compression of the core itself. You'd like to induce flow, and that flow is induced typically by pumps underneath the equipment. This is how we control the head, which controls the gradient. The gradient is actually the head divided by the length of the specimen. You do that by increasing the rheostat, and that controls the pump, the velocity of water out of the pump. And you can see that we arrive at the head. You can fine tune it so you don't make a lot of turbulence at the top. The gross change in the head, though, is the pipe, and you can change the elevation of the pipe, as you can see. And this is an overflow pipe and allowing a different head. Here is a very high hydraulic head with the gradient increased. You can see quite radically that we will change the head by dropping the tube significantly, and that's how the head is controlled. For the gradients are anything from 1, which would be a vertical wall, to somewhere around 1 to 2%, and that our typical 2% is a bottom grade for a landfill. You can see the inlet water is flowing through the specimen in plane and then flows out at the end. You typically monitor this by a bucket or graduated cylinder and a stopwatch. You're looking at flow rate with respect to time. Obviously, the higher the flow, the bigger the bucket you'll need. Sometimes we close off this bucket with a valve and subsequently collect that with respect to time. You control the gradient typically off of manometers. This is the one for the outlet, and this is similar one for the inlet. You have to make sure that there are no air bubbles in the lines so that you get an accurate reading with the manometers. For very low gradients, we typically use a pressure transducer. This pressure transducer is strapped across the back here, and we can control the gradients off of this monitor. Okay, this is a hydraulic head of about 0.1, and now I'll apply a compressive normal stress, ever increasing. You see the flow rate, it's pretty consistent now, but we should wait 15 minutes for this flow rate. We'd use a stopwatch and a graduated cylinder, or for this particular flow rate, we'd have to increase the volume. This tear is of known weight, and we could weigh it. But here you have a pretty consistent flow rate through this, and I'll show you by increasing the normal pressure, this flow rate will decrease. And what we're doing is, in effect, crushing the core with respect to time, and you can feel the, or I can feel the flow rate decreasing. You see the flow rate has slowed significantly, and basically we've crushed the core with respect to time. This is ASTM D as in David 4716 transmissivity. You need to have three gradients and three normal pressures to get the total curve, which you'll see close up in the subsequent slides. And we'll certainly show you the calculations. You do have to see the temperature of the water and try to maintain that as close to 20 degrees C. In addition to this, we'd like to show you an internal reference material. This material is what we use for the reference board. We can get flow rate through this consistently, and this is our IRM, or internal reference material, which we use for repeatability within our lab. So this is transmissivity, or in-plane flow. You will see a radial flow device in the subsequent slides, which is ASTM 6574, but it's used for flow or transmissivity through a needle punch non-woven. For all planar materials, this is the transmissivity box which is used. Okay, signing out from the Hydraulics Lab in the Geosynthetic Institute in Folsom. Thanks for watching, and we appreciate your attendance. Thank you.